My name is Marie Yancey, and I'm the mother of Jay Dilla. I'm very happy to have this opportunity to thank all of his fans. I'm happy as I can be for the support that he has been given. Lets me know that his work is not in vain, and all of the work that he has will live forever. There's so much more that's going to be given to the world, and this was his wish during his illness, that he'd be able to give his gift to the world. He was able to live long enough to give that gift back, and it'll last a lifetime. I'm so proud. I'm not mourning because I'm rejoicing. I've been so blessed to be the mother of a genius of music. And once again, I'd like to thank you, all of you, for all of your support, all of your love that he felt from everyone, all those that he worked with. He loved you all, individually, especially. Thank you.
Talent, most talented musicians.
But, you know, think about it. As fans of music, all we need sometimes is a gift, is just a person creating what they're supposed to create, and we getting to experience it. You know what I mean? That's a gift too.
I feel you, dang. We about to get it. Oh my God. So serious. Turn me up a little louder. Get it crunk, yeah, let's get a riled up. Let's go, it's only for my real niggas. Big truck, Dilla lay fifth wheel with his thick pink gators. My Detroit players, game like air, that's why these boys hate us. Jeez. We let the Maurice tell the whole story. Bouncing the 40, watch your whole
sporting.
Party up, get live with it.
Perfection.
Start it up, put it in drive and whip
aggressive.
It. Move, bitch, get out the way. I'm so bouncing a mile in and out the lanes.
Colorful.
It's not the game. Fuck a niggas up like what to go, what to go, what to go. The low theory, all you feel is the bottom. You ain't gotta wait to
when
drop
I make my music, you know what I'm saying? I want people to feel what I feel. I want to feel that energy that I, whatever it was. That's all it is. Cause I make it straight from the heart.
The greatest, man. For real.
All the way from DJ.
Beginning, that was always the case with me. All day, I tell people all day, I'm in the studio from my time I get up, time I go to sleep. I mean, I leave out, go get something to eat, that's it. It's like, I can't do anything else.
Like, I would go to the basement, man, and lose track of time. Like, I go there at like 1 o'clock in the afternoon, just chilling, and look up and it's like 3 a.m, and we still down there bouncing. Like, he's just making beat after beat.
Like I get the inspiration from talking to people like Pete Rock, Diamond D. Like every time I call Pete,
you
he's in the basement.
Guys,
yeah, it's like every time I call him, he's working.
Yeah.
Every time I call Diamond D, he's in the lab. So it's like it's nothing for me to do but do the same thing.
It was a great experience, you know, being around him. We gave each other a lot of inspiration. I would call him on the phone, no matter what time of night it was. If I had a beat going that was crazy, I was letting him hear it. Like, it didn't even matter. Like, yo, listen to this, cousin. Then he'll do the same thing.
He's into making beats so much, you know, sometimes he don't even stop to eat. You know what I mean? You have to tell him, hey, Dilla, come on, man, stop, get a little bite to eat. Mm-hmm. He's so, you know, he gets so engulfed in what he's doing. He loves it so mm-hmm. much that he's just got that drive and determination right. Just to work all the time. You know what I mean? He's more like a workaholic to me.
I mean, shit, he ain't go to shows. He would have shows he's supposed to do. He'd be like, nah, nah. Back to work. I'm not done yet. I'm not getting up until I'm done. And I'm the only one who knows when I'm done.
You know, it's like when you're doing a beat, it's sort of like when you watch Core TV, you see the person, you know what I'm saying, taking the notes. You know what I'm saying, at the courtroom. And it's like they doing the shit like they could just be, you know, zoning off on some other shit. And it's like they could eat a sandwich while they doing the shit. It's so natural to them, you know what I'm saying? That's how he is when he making the beat. That's how he did it, you know what I'm saying? It's just like, it looked like real natural. Like he could just, you know, he could do whatever he wanted to. Like that was breathing in right there. You know what I'm saying? That was the hot seat.
His house was like a lab in the basement. And he was definitely a scientist. He had records lined up all around the walls.
Go up to the turntable with a stack of records, put the headphones on. And he go through some joints, do needle drops, whatever, find some shit. And he take the headphones off and he just start nodding. And you could just see the whole shit forming in his head. You know what I'm saying? The joint, he had the joint done before the MP was even turned on.
Well, what's
up? Like, I mean, I got all that shit. You know, right. That shit, I just want to get something for the phone to be something else.
For the what?
Just for the basic.
Yeah, because I want to take it somewhere else too.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
But I mean, yeah. From the basement. But we would go there, and man, I just remember him going through the records. He would sit there. Sometimes he'd keep the headphones on before, you know, while he would make it. And then, so you could hear it, and then. He have it cooked up and he just pump it. You be like, oh man, what is this? You go, you know, you just go crazy over the music. You be like, damn, we were like Nah Chompa. This is. And that's when I named that song Nah Chompa.
It's dope to look back on it started here. The light was the first song. And Nah Chompa was them two. And that's where it started for this album.
And the thing that cats gotta understand, this is why Jay's the best producer of all time. It's one of many reasons that Jay is the best producer of all time in hip hop. Of all time, number one. No doubt. 15, 20 minutes, bro. What can you do in 15 minutes? Find your motherfucking sample? You know what I'm saying? The beat is done already, and it's the best shit you ever heard in your life. This shit makes no sense, man.
The level that he was on is just like. Push me to a whole level. So watch a cat make a beat in like 10 minutes and this is like the baddest shit you ever heard. You just like, oh God, I can't take all day.
Like the things you gotta listen for. When people ask me like, what do you listen for when you listen to Dilla? It's like the perfect haircut. It's like the perfect Philly beard, which clearly I'm not displaying right now.
Like this music made me just, I could write the best songs with this music. I could just ride and feel free to this music. I can fight to this music. I can do with, you know, just so many things to how good this music is. But it was a spirit of more than anything. It just felt good.
Whenever you listen to a JD beat or whatever, you get the feel good. I call it the feel good. It's that, it's either that or it's that it's whichever way, it's I call it the feel good.
Hip hop, but you didn't really think like hardcore. It was just like, ooh, you around with some pimp shit with this shit.
Feeling. I mean, he made the MPC 3000 sound like a band. You know what I'm saying? He made records speak as if like each instrument was somebody really playing it. Especially his drums. His drums sound like someone just really rocking it. You know what I'm saying?
Personality, you know what I'm saying? I think once you hear that, you want that, you know what I'm saying? Be like, man, I gotta figure out a way to put my personality into a joint too.
I guess the best thing you can say is the bounce his shit has, you know what I'm saying? The bounce the Jay shit has, it's just, that's Jay's shit. And you hear it, and it might be, the tracks might sound different, you know, it might be some up-tempo shit or some of his wild shit.
He went through his Indian, East Indian movement, where he's just doing East Indian beats.
He had some real wild shit for a minute.
He went through his Kraftwerk period, where he's just making computer electronic beats.
I just appreciate the soul.
He went through his big drum phase.
Hey, listen to that personality though, man.
He went through his club phase.
He really just did say so much.
He went through his spare, you know, one note. Beat making phase.
He spawned some crazy shit, man, for real.
He went through street hip hop phase. Like he went all over the place and he showed range.
You know, he was always constantly reinventing himself, you know, on a monthly basis.
What I do is when I make CDs, I put like two batches per CD, 24 beats per CD. And it's like last year I did five volumes. It was like 24 beats and 5 CDs. Do the math, huh?
Yes.
But you know, 100 plus beats.
You know, the batch you get this month didn't sound nothing like the batch you got last month. Didn't sound nothing like the month, you know, the batch you got the month before that.
People that have heard his beat tapes, you know that they're like snowflakes. Like, no beat tape was the same.
Also, I'd like to thank Q-Tip for introducing me to him, because when he first brought me his beat tape, I was floored. I mean, absolutely floored. Like, who is this? To the point where I had bought a ticket to go to Detroit just to meet home. You know what I'm saying?
I was just drawn to it, so much so that I wanted to just, like, work with Jay and get his stuff out with him.
Most definitely, because his beats weren't cutter. They weren't always simple. But even if he did do a simple beat, he did it, you know what I'm saying, in a clever way. So you would have to respect it.
I think a lot of people were biting his sound, and what he did to go to the next level was he started messing with like space sounds and like just abstract loops, and he was making like those loops soulful. He was making soul joints out of loops.
That was JD, you know what I'm saying? When you think about geniuses of the world, they come in and they do something a certain way and everybody try to follow like that. That was him, bro.
I respect it, because when I hear good shit, it makes me want to go make something, but not make something like what I just heard. That's the only difference. It's like they take the inspiration and then goes and do the exact same thing. I don't understand that. You know, people do it. People do it. You know what I'm saying? I do it. I get inspired. But you want to do you.
Your own.
Do your thing. Yeah, still do you.
I mean, motherfuckers knew that he was the fucking best when he was here. But motherfuckers wouldn't. I don't know, man. Motherfuckers wouldn't say that shit. What you niggas gonna bite now, man? What do y'all got to bite now? That's what I wanna know. I wanna know what is motherfuckers gonna bite now.
Jay is like the only producer in hip hop that has surpassed all of his influences.
He learned from Pete, you know, Pete Rock was an influence of his. And you can just hear how he just took Pete Rock's to the next level. Like
in the beginning of my career, you know, I did a lot of new things, you know what I'm saying? And this guy took it at least 2 or 3 levels higher than me. You know, it's like a chain reaction, you know, like basically it was like from Larry Smith to Marley Marl, from Marley Marl to Pete Rock, you know what I'm saying? From Pete Rock to JD.
Like, cause at least I think with Pete teaching it, JD could sort of absorb that information and apply it to his work.
I mean, you look at people talking about how, you know, Pete was Jay's idol. You know, Pete Rock was Jay's idol. But it turned into, like, Jay being Pete's idol, you know? And, I mean, before I heard Jay, Pete Rock was Jesus Christ.
I believe, like, I'm proud to say that he's the brand new king. He's been the king for a long time. I'm an old king, but I passed the torch on to JD, you know what I'm saying? The brand new king of beats, man. He's ridiculous, you know what I'm saying?
When I make my music, you know what I'm saying, I want people to feel what I feel. I want them to feel that energy that I, whatever it was. Yeah, that's all it is. Because I make it straight from the heart. So it's like, to be taken for anything else is crazy to me.
The passion he put into that music was just like, it was for the music. Like, this dude loved creating music, and you know, he just wanted to make good music. Like, stuff that just had that effect upon people. Just the stuff that he knew was like impeccable, and stuff that he knew that was like just the way music should sound.
Like, you listen to that music and you feel that in your chest, like, dang, what is that? You know, and that just lets you know right there. You don't even need to say a word.
I mean, when you hear the shit, it's soul music, man. It's from his soul, you know what I mean? So, I mean, you gonna feel it.
The thing that influenced me most about his production was that anything goes. You know, there's no rules. No rules.
A non-drummer has totally changed my way of thinking when it comes to music.
That cat just had that soulfulness about him. It's like, woo!
It's coming soon. We only got 3 more songs.
Once we get finished. Once we get this guy.
He's our last stop. He
There's a lot of people waiting for this guy right here.
He's ready with
it. Somebody. But yeah, just yeah, Bilal shit. It's gonna be crazy. Bilal sung over African rhythms from the Welcome to Detroit shit.
Yeah.
At the intro. Oh. Yo. Oh. Yo. Yo.
So that's yo. Stuff
yo.
You got. Yeah.
Yo.
I mean, being a keyboard player, I'm a big fan of melody, and the way he would melody and harmony, and the way he would put things together, like he would chop sounds that are chords and things and put it together in a way that it would create a whole new sound, and that was really impressive to me.
He was just amazing. Like, he taught me craziness. Like, and he said I inspired him, but he inspires me and continues to do that. You know what I mean? It's hard. You know, I could be here for hours just talking about it.
He's responsible for a piece of my heart and my musical growth and understanding. I owe a lot of that to him.
Just the stuff I heard, I just kept asking myself, like, are you allowed to do this? Like, he was breaking the law.
Anything that kept it was just funky. It's so fucking funky, yo.
JD taught me how to use the force, and when you use the force, you keep it simple, you can keep it sloppy, but just keep it funky.
Oh, wow. Yo, James, you look like dumb Donald.
Dilla had the biggest influence on me. I can keep the pocket. I don't have to out fancy none of these drummers. I can keep the pocket. Be as funky as I want to be, and on top of that, I can even be sloppy about it.
Jay's thing was like, I'm just going to do what feels good, you know. He changed the game in terms of like just, you know, the way he would chop these samples up.
Like, that's it. You watching that motherfucker on the MP. It's like, are you serious? Where the fuck is he from? How is he doing this shit?
Something esoteric or something from another, like, dimension or something. That's what I feel like.
I mean, he wasn't human, man. He couldn't have been, man, for real.
It felt like it was coming from another world in a way.
The nigga was an alien, man, flat out, man. I'm gonna keep it real, man.
It was really hard sometimes to just wrap your head around that shit watching. You know what I'm saying? Because it's just... like, that's... God just put him here for that.
Yeah.
God put Jay here for that.
He was sent here.
He totally opened a whole new door of what production was.
And I think JD was a producer's producer. You know, most definitely, because his beats weren't cookie cutter, they weren't always simple. But even if he did do a simple beat, he did it, you know what I'm saying, in a clever way. So you would have to respect it.
Most producers will just take four bars and program those four bars and then loop and then loop. And then, but Dilla was in a class by himself. I mean, he was adding accents and tricks and different feels as the song went on. If you said something tricky with your voice like this, then he would try to follow you, what you were saying. And then he would do it like, you know, and that's clearly the mark of someone not human, you know.
Another person was like, yeah, JD is so dope. Why is he not getting Timbaland, you know, Neptune's recognition and money?
Mm-hmm.
Now, my personal opinion on that is no disrespect to anybody, to Neptune's or Timbaland or whoever, but JD makes classics.
Yeah.
He doesn't make songs for right now. Every day he made, we will be singing forever. Yeah. That light is going to be around forever. Fall in Love is going to be around forever.
The passion he put into that music was just like, it was for the music.
Let the music speak for itself.
That's how you know somebody is really ill, is how humble they are. Like, you know, that's how you know
who's the killer in the room? You know? You know what I'm saying?
JD had that sensibility of a producer as far as rhythm and the quality of an MC.
JD producer versus JD MC?
Yeah, this shit going straight off wax on some old school shit. Old school shit. Damn, all right, check it out.
Cream, baby, cream.
You ain't gotta play hard to get. I know you like a hard for sex. I play it like a brand like a architect. It's for you, we can all get wet. I got a lot of nerves on this shit to you, right? I'm straight up, this shit makes sense to you. Girl, you ain't gonna crush, don't be acting dumb. If you got the goods, then I want some.
I think when he got in the booth, man, that was a point where he could just release all that aggression.
I think he spoke a part of him, you know what I'm saying, and everything that he taught.
Oh, yeah, because he talk a lot of shit with him, see. He talk a whole lot of shit with him, see.
For the most part, he was real reserved, but he got in that booth, man, he was a monster. It's like split personality down there, you know?
It's two different people.
He still had a hood element, that's what would come out in the raps.
Definitely an alter ego. He called him Nigga Man. Like, oh, Nigga Man coming out. Like, you know what I'm saying? He started talking about, yo, I got the range. You know, the Dilla A with the fifth wheel on the back. That was Nigga Man all day.
That was, you know what I'm saying, his alter ego. Like, that's what he really getting that swagger and that cocky shit out of.
That sure does come out with him.
What's up with this jealousy? What's up?
Yo, Jay, bring this shit down for the night.
Bring your last year, make you say, what the fuck? This goes out to the niggas, this fucking shit. Same nigga that be double tapes, you're walking this shit. No life, having like a bitch. Fucking a bitch, no joke, bro. Dog niggas be cracking me up. Playing hate, plot, better on backing me up. Don't do it, show them these niggas is back to me up. Hardcore. Fuck rap, clapping again, nigga, but hardcore. Then smack them up and act like what?
Shit like 55 in the back of the bus. Hot shit, SV, your smack of the fuck. Don't get jealous cause the S is stacking the bus. Say what say
you. To have that quality and to really have some like lyrics that you say and some stuff, that was something special.
Man, he was one of the illest MCs, man, to do this shit, man. He really fucking held his nuts when he fucking rhymed.
Stay in the rhyme, flawless. Shit fly like MJ in his prime. Off the wall with mines. I'm grabbing my balls when I rhyme. Nine's busting plus ball all the time. Now stay on your mind like great sex. You ain't on my mind, I'm thinking about paychecks.
And you know, he might be gonna be talking about some curls or something like that. And he'll come to me and he'll say, nah, you know, I'm just rapping. So, don't be tripping. And I'm like, okay. And then I'll hear it, I'll be like, raise it up.
I ain't doing my thing, I ain't doing a thing. I ain't got none of that dough, none of them cars. I ain't fuck none of them hoes and none of them bars.
It's funny to me, man. It's funny, man. That dude really was, he was really nasty, man. He was a nasty nigga.
We got the spot, swinging my chain like this, swinging my thing to these motherfuckers, bang my shit. I don't sit low, I ain't never pop Chris. This rollie just don't look right, sitting on my wrist, huh? What it mean? Dip the shine down.
He was just having fun. You know, just like making beats, he was just being another zone in the basement, man. He was creating lyrics, just beats, just having fun, you know what I'm saying? Not really forcing anything. Like, the thing I appreciated so much about, like, his MCing is he could say those things, but he would put them in a clever way. And it just sounded so good the way he put it. You know, you could talk about his chain many times, but it just, his cadence was so good. You'd be like, I don't want to hear that.
But he still has that rhythm, that swing, though, when he rhymes.
Jesus, MC, man, so much rhythm, you know, delivery. Like, Slum Village, that whole sound was JD to me. You know what I'm saying? Just the rhythm. It's fantastic.
You say, huh? What?
But you know, that's the whole JD delivery, you know, and that, nobody's really doing that, you know, rhythmically on the mic to me.
I really, really fucks with the whole rhyme pattern and the whole rhythm and the way they did the background vocals. Like, it was some very, very funky stuff. Shit that you just didn't hear during that time period. I'm sorry, you just didn't hear it.
You know what I'm saying? Because he was clever with his shit. And it's rare you see somebody that's clever with their shit and their style is ridiculous. You know what I'm saying? Their style had you. It's usually one or the other. Jay had them both, man. Same with the beats. You know what I'm saying? Style and substance.
I was like, man, this dude raps so good. Like, that's one of the things that people didn't get to really, like, see is his rapping is just, like, it's phenomenal, too. It's, like, really top-notch. A material.
Yeah.
That's the beginning, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, can't stop, quit. Stance and just push up your hands and fist. Come on for the band and if you can't stand. One of my man's stand sleeping on some sand, man. Shit. Come on. Like damn man, wake up.
Jemaya was very special today. She was very special to both of us. He always found time for Jemaya. He always, you know, found time for Jemaya. Even after me and him separated, he always played the part in Jemaya's life, you know, as a father. So I feel he balanced it well. So that was special. You know what I'm saying? That was important to me for him to do that.
He's such a beautiful person. You know, I can talk about the music, but just talking about him as a person, he was genuine. He was very quiet but deliberate. You know, when he was gonna state his opinion, he stated it honestly. Just very kind.
JD was fresh, man. JD was fresh, man. He would always come fresh. I would go shopping with him sometime, and he would go and pick the illest stuff. Like, let me get that. You know what I'm saying? Come with a whole pile of stuff to the truck, you know? Crib was crazy. He had racks of clothes. He had a room with just, it looked like a store. You know what I'm saying? He had racks and racks and racks of clothes. It's like you walk into a store, like, I'm gonna wear today. Sneaker boxes stacked up. It was just ill, man.
Damn. And they all was like real meticulously, like still in the boxes or still the clothes still had, he had the cleaners fucking sticky shit on it. Like, it was, that cat was like so pimpy. Yeah, that's the way to describe him. He was so pimped out with the music and pimped out with the clothes too, because every. Just the way, like, if it's a special record, it got this little thing over it. That's the way he kept everything. It was just like, everything was a collector's item. That's some hip-hop shit right there, yo. It's a very meticulous cat, yo. It's probably why he spoke so little, because he was just very meticulous about what he had to say and what he wanted to do. Now, if you want to be the best, you got to be the best all the time. Never let a moment pass where you're not doing your best. A few people do that. I think Jay really did that, yo. Everything he did, he was really at his peak with it.
That's the infinite team right there, me and JD. I'm working with him whenever I can, because he just like constantly progressing and growing. He one of the greatest producers, greatest musicians of our time. For real, I really know that. Like, I used to be able to wake up in the morning and hear Jay Dilla beats being made. You know, I really used to walk by me like, man, I'm blessed. Like, I really felt that, during the time when he was making it. Not like, I don't look back and say I was blessed. I know I was blessed, but during that time, I looked and said, man, I'm getting to see JD make beats every day. You know, as long as he was healthy, he was making music.
That took so much dedication, man. It just lets you know that how much he loved music, how much he loved to create.
I mean, as sick as he was, I mean, it would make the situation that much worse if he wasn't allowed to do his craft, you know?
That was his life, man. This dude fucking worked around the clock, man, on music. For real, for real.
It's incredible because for him to be as sick as he was and to continue to work like he did, it's just amazing.
You feel it seemed like it's everything but comfort there, you know what I'm saying? And I was just wondering, I thought to myself, like, you know, if I was in that situation, would I be able to create? Would I be able to make heat, you know what I'm saying? And I don't know if I'd be able to do it. So by him, you know, to actually cut albums, you know what I'm saying, from a hospital bed, is some genius shit in its own, you know what I'm saying? So I don't know how he did it.
Maybe the sheer need to make music, like, he's just figure out a way. Like, that's such a ghetto mentality. But he mastered it, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's a genius mind right there.
That was always the case with me. All day, I tell people all day, I'm in the studio from my time I get up, time I go to sleep. I mean, I leave out, go get something to eat, that's it. It's like, I can't do anything else.
It was really like the Welcome to Detroit tour, but it was really, you know what I'm saying? It was like his farewell, man. It was like his farewell tour, man. You know what I'm saying? Because it was postponed like twice. You know what I mean? And he the one who wanted to do it. You know what I mean? We did that because that's what Dilla wanted to do. You know what I mean? And you know what I mean? We get a lot of emails and shit from fans, like saying, like, you know, they were sad, you know what I'm saying, to see him, you know, in a wheelchair or whatever, but that's what he wanted to do, you know what I'm saying? He wanted to go out and reach out to his fans and let them know that he you know what I'm saying, he appreciate that shit, man. You know what I'm saying? I mean, he really appreciated that shit. And every night it was an emotional night, man. I mean, it was crazy, man. You see fans in the crowd crying and shit, man. Crazy. It affected me in a way, like, every night, you know what I'm saying? And in between the fucking, you know what I'm saying, days that we had off, he going to dialysis, you know what I'm saying? So, I mean, this nigga was a fucking soldier, you know what I mean? For real, for real. Still up there every motherfucking night, rocking, spitting, you know what I mean? Every night. It wasn't no, you know what I'm saying, no night where he, like, you know what I'm saying? Yo, I can't do this. And even if he would have done that, motherfuckers would have understood that. You know what I'm saying? But this dude rocked every night. He was making beats in the hotel room when we was over there. Yeah, it was emotional shit, but the shit was fun as hell, though. I mean, yo, we had a fucking ball. For real, for real.
You know, it's almost like it was planned out. He went over there, he came back, he finished the donuts. He finished the other projects he had to finish, man, and he said, hey, it's time for me to go home and be my Lord and Savior.
And it was getting close to the time for him to go. So he lived another few months until he made the final decision. I find peace with that, and I hope you all do too.
Sad thing today that we lost him, you know, because it,
we lost not only a good guy, a good person, we lost a great big icon to this music game that, you know, a lot of people are gonna get to know his music more because we're gonna keep it alive, you know what I'm saying?
If he can work in the type of position that he was in, then I can do whatever I need to do to be here for our daughter. Say hi, Grandma!
I feel like I have lost somebody that was on the front line of the army to save and preserve and respect and continue hip-hop in its fullest musical blossoming creative state. So it's like I feel like, oh my God, I'm lacking one musical purist. I'm now lacking one. Oh my God, and he can't be replaced.
That's another. I always try to get people to understand that like Jay's beats was perfect. Like he, nobody else could translate a record into production like him.
I know what I know, and I know that Dilla is the greatest beatmaker of all time.
The master. He mastered his instrument. You know, some people never do that in one lifetime. Like, he really mastered his instrument. The MPC, the drums, just hearing music, he mastered it.
And singing at the same time. How you do that shit? How you smoke? How you sing and smoke come out your mouth, man? For real.
Baby, I don't think twice.
I'm like, this not happening, dude. Dude never ceases to amaze me. You know what I'm saying? That shit ain't real. That shit can't happen in real life. You know what I'm saying? But that's something I always think about too, man. It's just crazy. It's crazy.